Imagine you're sitting on a couch and watching a movie. I come over and poke you in your stomach. Now you might not say something to me once or twice. But if I do this continuously for a while, you're going to eventually tell me to just back off. I go away and you hear a very small sound like a pen or a spoon falling. You won't care. Obviously, the movie is a lot more interesting. But the very next second, you hear a loud bang. Loud enough to make you put your phone away and run straight out of the house. So what we tried to understand with these examples was the different types of potentials that can be generated in a cell that make it change its current situation. The first case where you were just sitting on your couch and watching your movie, you didn't have any external stimuli to worry about. That is the resting potential of a cell. This potential difference is basically across the cell membrane. For example, there are some ions that are present across the lipid bilayer. If this is your cell membrane, there will be equal number of positive and negative ions inside the cytosol of the cell. Similarly, there will be equal number of positive and negative ions in the extracellular matrix of the cell. However, just across this membrane, this area will have a difference in charges. The inside of the cell will be more negative, while the outside will be more positive. And this difference that is generated due to this difference of charges here gives cells some potential. The more the difference between these charges, the more will be the potential of that cell. In the first case, that is the resting potential of a cell, this resting potential is negative. It is maintained by various different factors. The second situation where I came up to you and poked you in your stomach, it didn't matter to you once or twice. But my frequency and intensity was the reason where you reached the threshold of your patience and told me to go away. This was an example of a graded potential. And it works on the principle of summation. The third example of that noise was an example of an action potential. Either you're not going to care at all about it, even if it caught your attention for a while, or you're going to run out of the house without caring. This is the all or none principle. The potential generated in the cell here should be large enough for the cell to transmit it further, or it is not going to do anything at all. Now we should understand each of these in detail and we should know the difference between the graded potential and the action potential. The resting membrane potential, or the situation where the inside of the cell is more negatively charged, is maintained by various factors. The first one of them is an unequal distribution of ions in the extracellular matrix and the cytosol of the cell. The outside of the cell is rich in ions like Na positive, Cl negative, while the inside is richer in K positive and phosphates. Also, most importantly, K positive leaky channels in this cell membrane are a lot more than sodium leaky channels. Leaky channels are all those channels that can be present on the membrane that open and close randomly. They don't need any external stimulus, but they can just open and close randomly. So more K positive ions can move out of the cell, and therefore the inside of the cell will obviously be a lot more negative than the outside. The second thing that happens here is that most anions of the cell are not allowed to leave it. These are mostly membrane integral proteins that are embedded and thus cannot follow any of the positive ions moving out of the cell. Thirdly, there's the sodium potassium pump. What it does is it takes up the sodium ion, three sodium ions, from inside of the cell and it pumps them to the outside. In exchange, of two potassium ions that now enter the cell. This is done to correct all those leaky channels, that those sodium leaky channels that are present in the membrane that can allow the entry of some sodium ions to come in. These potassium ions that enter the cell can also make the cell positive. And these are corrected by the leaky channels that are present for potassium in the membrane. And this is how a negative 70 millivolt of resting membrane potential is maintained in the cell. Now we are going to talk about the difference between a graded potential and an action potential, both of these coming from an external stimulus and changing this resting membrane potential of the cell. The first thing that we are going to use to distinguish between a graded potential and an action potential is the range. Graded potential is a short range potential, while action potential is long. The second thing is the principle they follow. And as I mentioned earlier, a graded potential follows the principle of summation. This summation of the stimulus can occur over time, that is the temporal summation, or it can occur across space, which is known as the spatial summation. On the other hand, an action potential will work on the all or none principle. It will either occur or it won't at all. The effect on the membrane polarity of a graded potential can be depolarizing or hyperpolarizing, whereas an action potential will always be depolarizing. Depolarizing the membrane means that we are reducing that difference between the charges across the membrane. We are decreasing the potential, whereas hyperpolarization is the situation when that difference is increasing. That is, in depolarization of a membrane, the inside of the membrane will start becoming more positive, and in hyperpolarization, it will become even more negative. The duration and amplification of a graded potential. It is the intensity of this potential will be small, but the duration will be long. Whereas an action potential will have a high intensity, but it will occur for a very short time. Then there is a thing known as a refractory period. Refractory period is basically a period in which a cell can react to another stimuli while it is already in the depolarized or hyperpolarized state. In a graded potential, since it works on the principle of summation, this refractory period does not exist. Because as soon as there is a new stimulus, it will add to the earlier one and the intensity of both of them will add up and increase. Whereas in an action potential, refractory period plays a major role. And we are going to understand that once we know how an action potential is generated and how it travels along a cell. The amplitude of a graded potential decreases as it moves forward, while in an action potential, this does not happen. The amplitude remains the same. This basically is decremental, while it is not. Causes for an action potential to occur in the cell will be an external stimuli, like someone poking you, or it will be a neurotransmitter that can be released in your cells. A graded potential is the reason why an action potential is generated. It is the reason why an initial threshold is reached, and this generates an action potential in the cell. An example could be any external organ or receptor that you have in your body, like your receptors on your skin. These can react to temperature, pressure, and on all of these different reasons, it generates graded potential in the receptor cells. This can generate an action potential in your neurons, for example, that will tell you that this external stimulus is something that you need to react to. So now that we have understood all the different types of potentials that can be generated in a cell depending on the external stimulus, we can understand how an action potential is generated and how is it transferred to the next neuron or muscle cell or any effector organ. If you like this video, do subscribe to my channel for future explanation, share it with your friends, and don't forget to press the like button. Thanks for watching.